So, Smattery, are you guys having a pretty good game so far?
So, not really.
Watch movies or they watch watched Maleficent, and I was thinking of the Bechdel Test, and I was like, this is what it must be like to watch a movie as a woman, because there are no men in this movie I can relate to. There are no men who even talk to each other, and then there's like the eye candy Prince Charming, and I was like...
And I think it's a great way just to, because it's not a great way to rate a movie. I think it's a great way to get people thinking about representation of women in film. Because if you watch anything and you think about it, it's just, because it, otherwise, like a lot of watching Avengers, I was not thinking, does this go to the movie? Oh yeah, this is an awesome movie. But like, if you go back and you think about the Bechdel Test after, I think the most common response is gonna be, huh, I guess it doesn't pass the Bechdel Test. It's a great way to just get thinking about how we can be better, you know, right? Better female character. Not even female character, but better female interaction.
I think, yeah, jumping off point is what it is. It's a way to get people thinking, it's a way for a light bulb to go off on, in somebody's mind. It's simple, you can remember it, but does it really work to show that it's a well representing women in our culture? No.
Yeah, I mean, I think it is a beginning point, but listening to a conversation on Twitter about what the next step might be, and some of the suggestions were, hey, let's start looking at some other things, like, let's look at crowds in film and television, and look at how many women are in, you know, crowds. Let's start counting the number of sentences that women say versus men say in or screen time. These would be maybe a next step to start talking about real representation of women. Not to say that the Bechdel Test, I think Alice Wechter will show low level bar that we're crossing here. This is just the beginning. And she, I think she meant it that way. It's almost laughable that so many tests don't even, so many movies don't even pass the Bechdel Test because it's so easy. It's like, you know, jumping over 2 inches. Wow, great accomplishment.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. It was something that was defined and brought up because there was an unawareness of it. It was a nice, sort of easy way to be aware of the fact that there are often not enough women characters who are significant in media, and having lives of their own outside of the function of the male characters. And obviously it's not like, hey, I check the box, like bad writing is bad writing. It's like there's the tough one and she always polishes her gun and check. I mean that's not it's Michelle Rodriguez. That's sometimes I feel like that's a function of, you know, male writers and creators dominating the voices of things, but also, you know, just to check the box, that's not solving a lot. It requires a lot of depth, and unfortunately, there are problems that are not necessarily sexist, and there are problems in production, and there are a lot of reasons why bad writing gets done, but inevitably, a lot of women's roles suffer because of it, and it's nice to have a Bechdel Test as just a starting point.
So what do you look for in, I guess you would say, feminist film, or is it different to have an expectation of a correctly or nicely portrayed woman in film, and does that define a feminist film?
I want to hear from the actress first. Like, I want to hear from the actress. Can you get a script? Like, what do you look for when you decide what project you're going to do?
I mean, I guess, you know, I'm kind of unusual in that I do a lot of other things but acting, because I like being behind the camera. And in fact, I think it's more valuable to encourage people and women or people with diverse backgrounds to be behind the camera. Because honestly, that's where the tone of things is set. That's how things are chosen to get made. Really, actors are the last step in creation in Hollywood, and although we kind of deify them a lot, and they are obviously the focal point, how we identify our entertainment, they really are the least important in a sense of from creation, the start of creation to actually filming. So, you know, as somebody who doesn't, I'm not a primary lead actress, I do a lot of things. Like, I get offered a lot of roles who are the quirky one, or the friend, or like the fourth lead girl. And in fact, those are the more interesting roles. I feel sorry for almost the prettiest and most standard looking girl in Hollywood, because to me, when I watch a Sandler film, I laugh, but then I'm like, in a bridesmaids and stuff, where it's only about a woman, to be able to have fully fleshed out from the characters. So really, it's the most dominant, like the girlfriend and the wife and stuff, that I think need to be cracked more and thought of in a more in-depth way, because that's the primary woman you think of as part of the narrative. So I'm kind of lucky in that I'm a little bit weird looking and a little bit weird acting. I don't ever get, nobody would ever be sexually attracted to me. I'm not going to be the guy, the girl the guy finds at first. It's never going to happen for me. That's totally fine. That's all
fine. I'm going to see what she's saying, but yeah.
I think primarily it's a function of getting more women behind the camera, and also guys being a little bit more open to real interactions with women in their life versus like the cookie cutter version.
So then I have a question. What can men do behind the camera to encourage more films to pass the bechdel test?
I would argue a lot that
argue, but I was just going to have a point that you're totally right, but a lot of women will say, hey, we'll be okay with that. In fact, we'll steer you to making a cliche female character because it's not, people, you know, gender roles are not on the forefront of people's minds, especially in production. Like, it's not, you know, they're not looking at things through that lens. They're looking for, like, I want to make this a success, so my job is here.
And that's what they've seen, and so that's what they've seen.
And so, yeah, I mean, I think we're all kind of defined by the cliches that we're presented with. We're all kind of raised in sort of a worldview. It's like a viewfinder. Everybody's got a viewfinder of what, you know, a movie looks like. And because movies have inevitably shown, you know, female characters or male characters or ethnic characters, or, I mean, everyone falls into cliches across the board, and people in development, especially, they say, oh, no, this doesn't conform to the cliche of what I know and, you know, an old person in New York acts like, or a wife acts like. So it really is across the board of just like people on all sorts of levels telling stories that are different and showing people that, oh yeah, we can have Sleepy Hollow, we can have an African-American woman be the lead and it's cool. They don't have to have, you know, sex with two guys. You know, it's not, everything doesn't have to be about men and women, you know, having sexual tension between them, which I think is a really good revolution in your show. So that's why
you're saying there's not.
Really? I mean, they were like, well, there's a little, but it's not a primary, like, thrust of,
no, it's
of, like,
not the primary, I agree, it's not the primary. Persevere, just keep pushing. You will encounter a lot of walls, and you will hit a lot of negativity. But like, so with Charity and I on the show, how many episodes are we on now? 150 almost. Mm-hmm. And we've been doing this for a couple of years now. And in the beginning, it wasn't easy. You have a lot of people who are like, oh, really? Another geek podcast? Oh, but you're girls? Ugh. But we just push through it, and people will start to listen to you and see that your ideas are actually valid, and that your opinions are actually valid, and that you can create something just as good as everybody else. So that's the biggest piece of advice, or whatever that I have for girls who are trying to create. Just keep doing. Just push past all the negativity, and you'll get there.
I'm not a creator, I'm a consumer. I think that's how I got stuck here. No, not stuck, totally wanted to be here, but I think there's a responsibility on my end that I need to really support those shows, those movies, everything that I see that is actually woman friendly. Like, I'm gonna watch the hell out of Agent Carter.
anti-men. It's not anti-men, it's just not misogynist. Like, if you think that anything that's not misogynist is anti-men, I'm very, very sorry for you. So I think just doing the work, but expecting it to be easy, I'm sorry, it's just not.
It was extremely helpful for me to force, like, the people that I give this lesson to, I give them a grade. They don't have any other options but to sit and listen to me rant and rave, and then they have to write a paper about how right I am. The guys will always run forward because these are small sets where maybe your jobs aren't delineated really clear. And the guy will go forward, let me get that for you, honey. And this guy she was telling, he just like stopped. And he said, I do that. I don't want that to happen to my daughter. And so he had a like a moment. So it just, you know, once in a while we'll get those moments, and that's how it's gonna happen. Just and it'll slowly spread. We can't expect tomorrow for everyone to understand the concepts.
One level at a time.
So we have a panel of writers, athletes, and scholars. They're all very professional and all very educated. So you're a panel of actors, writers, scholars, educated. Each of you must have your own opinion of what a strong female lead is, but we keep throwing that out. This is an academic panel. I would love to hear in just a handful of seconds from each of you what you thought a strong female lead is.
In my opinion, a strong female lead is someone who has an opinion and expresses it.
I mean, I struggle with the idea that there's one idea. Like, if somebody said, let's tell us what one male, what is a strong male lead? I mean, everybody would be like, there's so many different kinds. I mean, you can have, my work is all about a strong female lead who's a stay-at-home mom and investigates murders on the side, gets into lots of trouble. But, I mean, I think that that's an unusual strong female lead, and I did that on purpose because I get a little tired of having the only kind of strong female lead be, you know, somebody who's dressed in armor and, you know, sexy and hot and kicks butt. I mean, that is one kind. But again, that's like a low bar to me, like making the female character into a sexy version of the male character. I think there are thousands of different kinds of leads. There's, you know, lesbian women, there are disabled women, there are women of color, and we need to have all of their stories. There's not one story.
That's the best way to say it. I was a stay-at-home mom for many, many years. And I consider myself a strong character. So yeah, as you can go from, you know, Scarlett Johansson as Black Widow, thank you, to the stay-at-home mom who's investigating murders, to, you know, whatever. It's just well-rounded and various.
I think in examples, and so when you say strong female lead, because I'm at Comic Con and I'm wearing the shirt I'm wearing, like, for me, I would look at Donna Noble. And I love her for it, and she's very non-traditional in her looks. She's, you know, she's not a skinny waif like a million pounds. She's just out there, and she's, you know, I love her, everything about her. Yeah, I want to marry her and have her baby. I just really hate that term. It just makes me so tired because it's just such a cliche, and it just reminds me of a girl with really good biceps. A woman character who has her own agency, where you can, and I think it's more empathy. Like, you can look at a character and suddenly the whole thing can pivot into their shoes and you can believe them as a character. And I think a lot of the times, and this is, you know, with male characters too, but I think it much more with female characters, where they're just kind of like there to motivate the guy to do something or feel something bad about themselves. And you don't really see, hey, that's the wife show. I can totally see that wife named Leslie. I think it's your world. Like, you can't a lot of the time. And I think that's sort of the measure of a character, big or small, that you can see her story and believe her as a real character and not just a kind of a cutout. So it, whether it's her story or just she's a secondary character, I like that.
To an extent, you have to look at it as that even though it, on the surface it's a strong female character or a really interesting character, it is still, in a lot of cases, a male interpretation of their fantasy of a strong female character or their fantasy of a manic pixie dream girl. And so I think to break out the archetype, can this girl be your sister? Could this girl be your neighbor? Could this girl be your mom? Could this be your aunt? Is this someone you could actually know in your life, not just somebody to emulate after? That's just my two cents. Next question.
First is just something I want to tell both you and the organizers of the convention is thank you for having a panel of action women talking about this.
This year at FanX, they have more geek girl-related panels than they have any year before.
Male professor at the university I was working at came up to me and he's like, is that a boy or a girl? And I was like, oh, it's not a girl.
He's like, well, why are you dressing him like that? He's like, well, you know, I actually believe in, you know, having gender-neutral clothing on my daughter. And he's like, that's so bad for her. It's really important for her to know that she's a girl. When I see little girls, if you have that gender marking on their clothing, even I, and I'm aware of this, what I'm doing, I will see those little kids and say, oh, can I get you a doll? Whereas if I see a little boy, my first inclination is to be like, let me get you the Legos. But we need to, like, those cues that we have in our culture are enormous. They work on little tiny children so that already at 18 months old, kids know, oh, little girls have to play with the dolls and the little boys get to play with the Legos. So buy your Legos, buy your dinosaurs, and don't always make her have to look like a girl.
Don't assume anything about her. And also, any movie that you watch or show that you watch, ask yourself if you would want to see your daughter acting like that. If not, it's probably not good for her to watch either. And be just as aware of your little boys, think I'm not raising them to think, you know, that they are stronger and better than they think. Figure out. Although I don't want men open doors for me, so, you know, you can still say that. Whoever gets there first opens the door.
We need diverse books. It's a project that is about diversity and getting diverse books into the hands of kids who need to see their own representation on the page.
Does anybody care to follow A Mighty Girl?
Yes!
Mighty Girl, Amy Poehler, Smart Girls. Amy Poehler's doing some really cool stuff, you guys, with book recommendations. She does a Q&A and she'll live chat with girls and boys, but those are two of my favorites. I'm also a homegrown Utah one, is Beauty Redefined, which addresses body image issues. Really great stuff for how to think about yourself other than, you know, outside the societal norm.
I'm in a web series called The Socialist. You can find it on YouTube. It's not, it's got about equal male, female, with a female lead to it. So if you're interested in that, I think we're going through a second series and we'll need some funding for that.
Gender or race or age or anything, like I can talk to that person for 2 hours.
about the thing I love, and that's what I love about Kingdom, but is there a trap in making more, you know, empower panels like this and saying, you know, more keep track of things? Is that sort of diversifying in a way that creates barriers between men and women? I don't know, is that a weird thing to bring up? I just would like to know.
I think it's basically like characters, that you want a variety of characters, so it's okay to have a female, all-female panel one time, an all-male panel another time, and a mixed panel, just as long as it's all open and we get representation of everybody. I think that's what we need.
But how do you break through consumer culture, which is very divided by sex? And I see that as a producer, like you know, oh, it's a girl channel, or we need to like make girl content, but can't be two girls because the guys will leave because they're like, oh, screw this, I have a bad, you know, I have a romance book club where we talk about genre books. And like, I didn't move it because of that, but I moved it because I think it could grow better if we started fresh from the dominantly male place. And it's like all these consumerist things that sort of drive behavior, and you can see people with the best of intentions struggle with it. And most people don't care, they're just gonna go with the most popular, like the boob shot right here. Because inevitably, a picture of my face is gonna get 100,000 more comments than me like behind a camera when it was so how do you break those down without going, you know, directly? I don't know. I'd just love to hear.
I mean, I don't think there's an answer to that, because I think what we're seeing is the subtle power of the patriarchy to really take, like, every move that you make, to try to give women more power, that I feel like the patriarchy ends up taking it back and pushing them back into, you know, the place. When I'm in when I was taking classes at Princeton, one of the biggest problems that I had was the professors there all only taught the male writers, because they kept saying, well, the male writers are the important ones. They're like, well, you know, we could teach you the female writers, but if you want to get a job, you have to know the male writers, because those are the ones that everybody considers important. And unless the female writers started writing like the male writers, they were never going to be considered important. And if female writers were choosing topics that were, like, the men who were in charge of deciding which books were most important were always going to choose, you know, people who had topics that they were interested in. And I don't know that there is a way to break that down. So I feel like my job is to be a critic and to point out every time that this happens. I don't feel like there's a way to get around it. You just have to point it out when it happens over and over again.
Well, but so here's the thing is, I've been to a couple of the other girl geek panels during this con, and the audience has always been half male. Why would guys want to come to a panel about the daily life of a geek girl? Why are you guys here? I mean, obviously, we have Felicia Day here. Why are you here? Like, you're here to learn about the Bechdel test and why it's important, and it's obviously driven more towards a female culture, but there's guys here.
Yeah.
Because you guys are already, like, on board, so.
Yeah.
Although money is important, it's a different paradigm, whereas, you know, Hollywood's going to take a lot longer, although they're starting to make a few changes, but because money is so entrenched and the good old boy is so entrenched, it just becomes more difficult. So it's almost like two different
things. But they follow the money.
Yes.
So they follow consumer culture, which is, you know, young boys and young girls driving spending patterns, and then they completely are gendered. Like, you know, but it's frustrating.
It is frustrating, but I'm starting to see from the younger crowd coming up a little more, wow, women are doing this, that's really cool, kind of a thing, and so I have hope.
Yeah, it's also a question of a chicken and an egg question. Like, I've had how many conversations with somebody about, like, a Wonder Woman movie would never work because men would never go see a Wonder Woman movie, which I don't understand, because check out that outfit, of course you'll go see it. How does this work that we know you'll never see a woman-driven project when you've never made a female-driven project? So, like, you are self-fulfilling your own prophecy, and you made a movie about a freaking rocket raccoon, which was great, but, like, we'll watch a rocket raccoon movie, we'll watch Guardians of the Galaxy, but a woman is so much, like, unrelatable.
I think it was a really great discussion. I think it went a lot of really good places, and it is really difficult because it's a balancing act, I think, and you know, with consumer culture, it is so hard to control your audience and try not to overstep what your audience's comfort level is, but at the same time, push issues that are important. I think it's hard to say, how can I make something in my own voice without creating any divide? It's an interesting conversation. It's an interesting problem to try to solve, I think. How do you be inclusive and still be heard? So I think it's a really great conversation, and I'm glad that we had it. I do want to make time for your question. I think we have maybe two more.
I feel like that's have such a narrow view. What kind of extra rules do you think they need? So maybe one thing that you can add to it that could expand it and help improve movies in the future?
Great question.
I get like really excited because when I explain the Bechdel test to people, I always add this one addendum, that the women have something to do.
I had a panel on Sundance the other day with a bunch of really smart ladies, and nobody could answer that question for me when I moderated. I don't know.
I totally think if a woman can make a plot-driving decision, that makes a huge difference.
Maybe if a woman makes a decision that opposes the will, you know, is counterintuitive to the male. I mean, something like that, like where they're like their agency derails the needs of the guy character, not in a cliche way, but in a way that is from her character. You said it much more. I think you said the exact same. Just much better. You're really good.
Best friends.
I think we
have
room for one more.
Hi, I'm really happy that this panel is happening. My original question kind of already got answered, but my question is, what's your favorite piece of media, or what are your favorite pieces of media, one that does pass the Bechdel test and one that does not?
Oh.
No, dear.
Martha Jones sort of sends it off the rails.
Woo!
She's all about the love and all the
let's just do some stuff, okay? I'd say one of my newest series that I really enjoyed in the past, this would be The Librarians. And my deepest, darkest secret would be the Hallmark Christmas movies.
So if somebody wants to shout something out, or for the back, I'll take it, yeah! And then, everyone else, right? Avengers and Friends, I'm rewatching Friends because it's on Netflix. Firefight even sometimes.
Well, Dragon Age definitely passed.